Hello learners, I am Dr. Aman from Central University of Jammu. I welcome all of you in NIUS studio at Delhi. I am deliberating on the topic which is related to the teaching of sciences, and the name of the topic is Self-Reflection for Self-Actualization and Inquiry into Personal Life. My whole discussion, friends, will be confined to the following points. The learners, after this interaction, they will be able to understand the meaning of self-actualization. They will be able to define and elaborate the term self-actualization. They will elaborate the importance of self-reflection in learning, enumerate the ways to guide students' reflection. Of course, they will understand the skills developed as a result of self-reflection. They will be aware about what is inquiry into personal life. They will enumerate the benefits of self-inquiry for learners. Now, friends, as you know, in this topic, the term self-actualization has been introduced. And before going to the main topic, I would like to clarify what is self-actualization and who coined this term. So, this term, firstly, it was coined by an organismic theorist, Kurt Goldstein, and later on, Abraham Maslow discussed this term while he framed his theory on need hierarchy. You can see the hierarchy of need on the slide also, friends. I would like to just briefly explain this thing so that we can actually reach at the explanation of what actually self-actualization is. So, friends, he divided his need hierarchy, Abraham Maslow, he divided this into 5 stages, that is physiological needs, safety needs, belongingness and love needs, esteem needs, and lastly the self-actualization. He considered safety and physiological needs as the basic needs, esteem needs and belongingness and love needs as the psychological needs. And lastly, he termed self-actualization as the self-fulfillment need. So far, basic needs are concerned, friends. Firstly, we will be discussing the physiological needs, which is nothing but the basic requirements for mankind, that is food, shelter, and water. Safety needs, everybody requires safety. Even animals, they try to remain in herds, which provide them a kind of safety. Then if these two needs are satisfied, then we proceed ahead and then we try to see other needs, that is belongingness and love needs, where we try to see some relationships, we try to create our friends, we try to intimate with those friends. And then at last, or second last, esteem needs, which is the feeling of accomplishment, where a kind of ego is involved, that you found something, and lastly, the self-actualization. So, which is nothing. He explained self-actualization as achieving one's full potential, including creative activities. That's what we are going to study in the self-reflection topic, which is related with self-actualization, that is the realization of the full potential of the students. So, friends, all these needs are interconnected. If somebody is not, he has not taken meal, he will not be able to satisfy other needs. So, basic needs are to be fulfilled first, then we can take the child to the self-actualization. Now, friends, we are coming to the main topic, that is what actually self-reflection is. Self-reflection is like looking into a mirror and describing what you see. It is a way of assessing yourself, your ways of working, and how you study. To put it simply, reflection means to think about something. Reflecting and composing a piece of self-reflecting writing is becoming an increasingly important element to any form of study or learning. Self-reflection is about learning from experiences and developing your own thoughts from the experiences. Friends, you can see that experience is the highest qualification. Books cannot teach you what experiences teach you. Anything which you feel from experiences, it will not be forgotten. It will remain throughout for your life with you. So why not we should connect the study or the learning of the student with the experiences? So that can happen only with the help of self-reflection. While it is a natural process, we often take unconsciously. We also try to facilitate reflection consciously, both in ourselves, in others, by asking questions. So friends, our mind also works unconsciously. Even if you are working, if you have to deliberate on some issue and you are busy in your home task, obviously your unconscious mind will be continuously working in that direction. Time to time, the thoughts will be, you know, coming up, going back in the mind, like the waves of the oceans. So unconsciously also you can ask your students, or you can tell the students that how to practice self-reflection. And consciously, by asking questions to the learners, we can tell how the self-reflection is important for the learning of sciences. Now, we will discuss why self-reflection is important. Reflecting helps you to develop your skills and review their effectiveness. Rather than just carry on doing things as you have always done them, it is about questioning in a positive way what you do and why you do, and then deciding whether there is a better or more efficient way of doing it in the future. So friends, in positive way, you can see, you can analyze your ways of performing, what you are doing. Are there other best ways with the help of which you can do that particular task better? The teacher told you, you need not to stick to that path which teacher told you. You can see other ways also. Then you can discuss those new paths with your teacher. By those paths, you will be again strengthening your learning. Proceeding ahead, I would like to add, in any role, whether at home or at work, reflection is an important part of learning. You wouldn't use a recipe a second time around if the dish didn't work the first time, would you? You would either adjust the recipe or find a new and hopefully better one. When we learn, we can become stuck in a routine that may not be working effectively. Thinking about your own skills can help you identify changing you might need to make. So I already discussed this thing with you, friends, that you have to meditate, you have to see again and again the direction in which you are proceeding. Is that right direction? Is that path which you are following? Is that strengthening your knowledge or not? So that way you have to check again and again, and friends, that will be completed only with the help of self-reflection. Then what kind of questions we should ask to ourselves while we have to, you know, perform self-reflection? So I have quoted some of the questions which I will read out one by one. Firstly, I will like to discuss the strengths. So friends, we can meditate on these questions as, what are my strengths? For example, am I well organized? Do I remember things? Such type of questions will help you to see your strengths, whether you are able to perform a particular task or not properly. If not properly, why you are not performing that task? Second thing is weaknesses. So in that, we will ask the question like, what are my weaknesses? And under that, for example, am I easily distracted? Do I need more practice with a particular skill? So if we meditate on the questions like this, we can have the glimpses on our weaknesses, and we can have the remedies accordingly, and we can strengthen again our learning. So far skills are concerned, we can ask to ourselves, what good skills do I have and what am I good at? So how I can perform a particular thing? In what way? Can I perform a thing in communicative way? Am I good in communication? Such type of questions you would ask to yourself related to your skills that you are possessing. Now coming to the problems, we would see what problems are there at work or home that may affect me. For example, responsibilities or distractions that may impact on our study or work. So we can meditate on such questions also again. Whenever we are in our office or we are at home or we are at school in learning situations, you can see what are the things which are distracting, which are keeping myself away from my learning. So if we have glimpse on those questions, if we meditate on those questions, obviously we can strengthen our learning and we can keep out the distractions. Moving ahead, if I have to see to my achievements, I will ask, what have I achieved? Do I have some achievements in the life? And if you see your achievements, obviously, friends, you will be happy that I have passed that class with this much percentage. That will give you inner happiness. I have done some good thing for my friends. I have strengthened the learning of my friends also with cooperation. I cooperated my friends. So these things will obviously tell you the strength of your achievements. Then about happiness, we can ask, are there things that I am unhappy with or disappointed about? What makes me happy? So friends, we can ask such questions to ourselves. What are the things? Why I am not happy sometimes? So if I see the things, because happiness is the ultimate goal of the life of the individuals. So we must see what are the distractors which are not making ourselves happy. So we have to see those things. To the solutions, what could I do to improve in these areas? If I am weak in a particular area, what kind of solutions do I have? Should I go to my teacher? Should I go to some text, good text? Should I improve my skills to do experiments, particularly in sciences? So I should try to see some solutions with the help of which I can improve my learning and strengthen my knowledge. Although self-reflection can seem difficult at first or even selfish or embarrassing, as it does not come naturally, you will find it becomes easier and practice, and the end result could be happier and more efficient to you. Now, friends, we will discuss how we can guide students' reflections. There are some strategies which a teacher can adopt. I will discuss these strategies one by one. These are discussions, interviews, questioning, and lastly, logs and journals. Now I am firstly coming to the discussions, how these are beneficial to the learners for their self-reflection and what role a teacher can play in this direction. Students realize meaning making is an important goal when reflection becomes the topic of discussion. For example, conduct discussions about students' problem solving processes. Invite students to share their metacognition, reveal their intentions, detail their strategies for solving a problem, describe their mental maps for monitoring their problems and problem solving processes, and reflect on the strategy to determine its adequacy. During these kinds of discussions, students learn how to listen and to explore the implications of each other's metacognitive strategies. The kind of listening required during such discussions also builds the habits of mind related to empathy, flexibility, and persistence. These are great qualities of human mind, friends. And your mind will be habitual. You can develop in the mind. If a teacher uses discussion properly, then these qualities, that is empathy, that means how much near you can go to something, some knowledge, to your teachers, what are the limits, then flexibility in your learning, and of course persistence, you have to keep on doing the things. So these are the main habits which can be developed with the help of discussion. Now friends, one term came to us while discussing discussion, and in the coming slides also we will see this term commonly used, that is metacognition or metacognitive strategies. So I will briefly discuss about metacognition and metacognitive strategies. Metacognition means thinking about thinking, what you are doing. Firstly, you are thinking, then you are doing. Then you are thinking again that what I was thinking, am I able to perform that thing properly? So that way, that kind of performance, that kind of thing which you do is called metacognition. There are some strategies related to metacognition which I will read one by one, how we can use these strategies in discussion and in other things like interviews. So first thing is identifying one's own learning style, preferences and needs. Everybody is having different needs, different preferences, different interests. So as a teacher, we should see what kind of needs or what kind of interest a particular student is possessing. Accordingly, we should try to manipulate our teaching and strengthen the learning of the students. Next point in metacognitive strategies is planning the task, gathering and organizing materials, arranging a study space and a schedule, arranging a study space and a schedule, monitoring mistakes, evaluating task success, evaluating the learning strategy. So these are some of the metacognitive strategies. Now friends, I would like to come to the next strategy, that is guiding students' reflection, and which is interviews. So interviews are another way to lead students to share reflections about their learning and their growth in the habits of mind. Interviews also provide teachers and students with opportunities to model and practice a variety of habits. Listening with understanding and empathy, thinking and communicating with clarity and precision, and questioning and posing problems. So that way we can see that interview, conducting interview, can also be a very helpful strategy for guiding the student's reflection. Thirdly is the questioning. Well-designed questions supported by a classroom atmosphere, grounded in trust, will invite students to reveal their insights, understandings, and applications of their learnings and the habits of mind. Here are possible questions to pose with each student. So first question I am coming across is, as you reflect on this semester's work, which of the habit of mind were you most aware of in your own learnings? Second question will be, or maybe, what metacognitive strategies did you use to monitor your performance of the habits of mind? Then, which habit of mind will you focus on as you begin our next project? What insights have you gained as a result of employing these habits of mind? As you think about your future, how might these habits of mind be used as a guide in your life? So friends, you see, such type of questions, if teacher uses with the students, again, will again be guiding the students' reflection and obviously will strengthen their knowledge and learning. Now, next is logs and journals. Logs and journals are another tools for students' reflection. Periodically ask students to reread their journals, comparing what they knew at the beginning of a learning sequence with what they know now. Ask them to select significant learnings and vision how they could apply these learnings to future situations, and commit to an action plan to consciously modify their behaviors. So that way, Writing logs nowadays becoming very common also in classes. As a teacher, we can practice this thing. Now we are coming, how students can facilitate reflection at themselves. So here are some points which will be telling us about this thing. First is, open up their apprehension while working with other people. Second, talk about their beliefs. What are their beliefs? How they think? How they want to perform? What are their, the beliefs which have come from their generations? So you have to break those beliefs and you have to tell your students to think about something new, new paths for learning. Then accepting oneself with all shortcomings. Nobody is perfect 100% for friends in this world. So we should be in a position to accept what are my shortcomings. Then trying to overcome mental blocks. What are the blocks which are hindering my learning? Then struggle with one's weakness is also necessary. We should diagnose, we should take remedial measures to remove our weaknesses. Proceeding ahead, writing proposal or personal diary of goals of learning and development. Preparing and maintaining self-progress book. Planning journey towards one's goal. Working on the basis of pre-decided. Criteria to evaluate one's progress. Developing artifacts individually and collaboratively. Now friends, I am coming to the skills acquired after learning reflection. There are various skills which we can develop after self-reflection. These skills are self-awareness, self-regulation, self-improvement, and learning how to learn. We will briefly see what are these skills. Friends, first is self-awareness. Being self-aware means having the ability to look within ourselves to get a clear snapshot of what our thoughts, beliefs, emotions, motivations, and our personality in general. It is not just simply being aware, but experiencing a heightened sense of awareness. Though this heightened awareness, you can more easily interpret your thoughts and emotions and figure out what your true feelings and motivations are. Self-awareness is important because once you are able to figure out these things about yourself, you can make the changes you need to make your life better. Now, about self-regulation, research consistently shows that self-regulation skill is necessary for reliable emotional well-being. Behaviorally, self-regulation is the ability to act in your long-term best interests, consistent with your deepest values. Violation of one's deepest value causes sometimes, friends, guilt, shame, anxiety. So we have to be particular about it. Emotionally, self-regulation is the ability to calm yourself down when you are upset and cheer up yourself when you are down. Now, skill related to self-improvement. It is an inner process aiming for a better, happier life. It is a process of inner change, adopting a positive mindset, get rid of negative habits, and building new positive ones. Self-improvement means building new positive habits and changing one's behavior and attitudes. It is a way to make ourselves better and happier. Self-improvement usually starts with awareness of ourselves and our behavior and the desire to improve and transform ourselves and our habits. So here, friends, the change of attitude is must, which takes a lot of time. So as a teacher, we should try to change the attitude of the students towards learning also. Lastly, the skill related to learning how to learn. It includes learners pay attention to his strengths and successes, then take them up a notch. Read more variety and more often. Learn from what other people are reading and doing. Ask for advice on how to improve. Ask questions and get curious. Take advantages of internet resources in a smart and manageable way. So friends, we saw how these skills are important. Now I'm coming to the last part of the lesson, that is inquiry into personal life. Self-inquiry or inquiry in personal life is the technique on investigating our inner self so that we can advance in our personal growth and self-development. Self-inquiry in this sense is not merely inner questioning or an exercise in thought, but is a technique of inner exploration to support the growth of our authenticity. It is usually done in a meditative state. Now, there are some needs which are to be seen while we have to perform self-inquiry. These needs may be related with our health and wellness, friends. If you are not in good health, obviously, learning will not be happening. Then relationships, then community, economics, ecology, and of course, self-realization. So there are some techniques for self-inquiry also. We can ask the student to lay down, to think about himself in a cool and calm way so that the things which are disturbing us, they should come to us. Then what are the benefits for the learners of this? If we are weak in a particular subject, we can inquire into ourselves, list up the difficulties we face in learning, treat them one by one, and the solutions can be sought out accordingly. In conclusion, friends, we can say that the self-reflection leads to the development of many skills and thereby add to the personality of the individual. Also, inquiry in personal life, equally important, which helps us to have a glimpse of our strengths and weaknesses and ultimately lead to the self-actualization, which is the nothing but the ultimate goal of almost various aspects of our lives. So with these words, I say thanks to all the learners. Hope you will be learning this topic properly after going through this interaction. Thank you very much.